Hi, very good evening. Let me know if I'm not audible. Okay, so we're trying this new setting for the first time and let me know if it is not audible for you, right? Very good evening all of you. Hi Srish, Ganga, Akshaya, Subhasish, BA. Hi, glad that you're all joining live. Yes, BA. Okay, very good evening once again. So I hope you have gone through the soft copy of MCQs which we posted in Google Group. Today we'll focus on a few MCQs from general medicine, right? So in continuity with our regular batch schedule. So we have a few questions to be discussed today. I hope you have solved them previously. So we'll just have a discussion pertaining to the same multiple choice questions, right? Okay, we'll start off right away. So coming to the first one, the onset time in botulism is, so we have something called as onset time, O-N-S-A-T-T-I-M-E. So what is this onset time? The question is, onset time in botulism is 6 to 8 hours, 12 to 16 hours, 20 to 24 hours, 24 to 72 hours. So what is onset time in case of botulism? Okay, thanks Rish for letting me know. Hi Mud Ibrahim. Hi Rohit. Hi Ashwarya, Samya, hi, a very good evening. So, what do you mean by onset time? And also, what is botulism? And why is it a serious condition or a disease which is considered to be very grave in nature? Hi Farheen, I'm so glad to hear from you after a long time again. Yes, Ganga. Okay, you say inoculation. So onset time is the time period between inoculation of infection to appearance of symptoms. Or Rohit says onset time is the time required to produce clinical symptoms. Okay, seems to be quite logical, but unfortunately that's not what onset time is. Yes, VA, right? Botulism is, yes, food poisoning because of Clostridium botulinum, right? Hi Shrika, very good evening. So onset time is a time gap or time lag from the first symptom till there is a first spasm. So that's the onset time. Onset time is the time lag or time period from, or we can say the time interval from the appearance of first symptom because of botulism till the appearance of first spasm. So that's onset time. So what do you think is a more appropriate answer? Onset time in botulism, 6 to 8, 12 to 16, 20 to 24, 24 to 72 hours. Yes, food poisoning caused by Clostridium botulinum, which releases, I mean this particular species is resistant to various harsh environmental conditions. They even form spores which are resistant to even heating, can survive a temperature of even 100 degrees centigrade. You can make a note of this point, right? And this Clostridium botulinum elaborates a toxin which is considered to be toxic to nervous system, neurotoxin. So this neurotoxin leads to neuromuscular blockade, as a result of which there will be autonomic and motor paralysis. This is very, very important. Because of this toxin, we have various clinical manifestations like generalized tetanus, there can be lockjaw, there can be opisthotonus, right, where there is arching of muscles of back, and also there can be risus sardonicus, right? So we have various clinical features associated with the same, which are very, very important. Okay, lethal dose for humans around 1 microgram. It depends. Okay, in fact, since we're talking about botulism, yes, we have different species. Anyways, in case of Clostridium botulinum, the onset time is 24 to 72 hours. Option D, 1 to 3 days is the onset time. Do make a note of it. Yes. Good. So as we discussed, Clostridium botulinum is a common environmental organism producing spores which can thrive to temperatures of even up to 100 degrees centigrade. It releases neurotoxin, which leads to neuromuscular blockage if ingested, and there will be autonomic as well as motor paralysis. And also make a note, the first symptoms like generalized nausea or diarrhea are seen 18 to 24 hours. So first symptoms are seen 18 to 24 hours. I mean, after the inoculation of microorganism, first symptoms are seen 18 to 24 hours after the inoculation, and the symptoms include nausea as well as, yes, generalized diarrhea. So from the appearance of these first symptoms till the appearance of first spasm, we call it as onset time. And also botulism can lead to cranial nerve palsies and then progressive symmetrical paralysis, right, because of the neurotoxin effects. And also, as we discussed, there will be generalized tetanus, and there will be spasm of various muscles in body. Spasm of mesiter muscle leads to lockjaw, right? And also spasm of various facial muscles leads to a condition called risus sardonicus, where you have grinning of face appearance. We have even discussed the same in one of the image-based, right? In one of the previous videos. And also, there is, because of spasm of muscles all over, there will even be arching of back, which is called as opisthotonus. Okay, and also death usually occurs in severe cases because of respiratory muscle spasm and failure to take in air, right? So there are various manifestations. Along with that, there can be laryngeal spasm, esophageal and urethral spasm, which can lead to dysphagia as well as urinary retention. And also there can be onset of spasms. And to be more specific regarding the onset time, if the disease is severe, painful reflex spasms develop usually 24 to 72 hours from the initial symptoms. This interval between the first symptom and first spasm is called as onset time, right? So the interval between the first symptom and the first spasm is onset time. I hope it's clear now. So onset time in case of in botulism is 24 to 74 hours, whereas the time interval for appearance of first symptoms is one day, that is 18 to 24 hours approximately. Right? So we have a lot many valid points pertaining to this question. Make sure you note down in separate notes. Fine. Now, let's move on to second question. I hope it's audible, right? Do let me know if there is any issue with audio or the clarity of the video. Okay. Now, moving on to second question. This is quite interesting, but also equally very important. Let's see how many of you are going to answer. The best predictor of long-term prognosis in HIV patients is viral load, CD4 count, both, none. So which one do you think is more appropriate? The best predictor of long-term prognosis in HIV patients is... Yes, even Botox, is it's also used for cosmetic purpose. Hi Devana, hi Bernice, hi Parichay. CD4 count, so most of you have CD4 count. According to who, it's viral load. Okay. Even according to Harrison's Internal Medicine, it is viral load. Option A is more appropriate. In fact, they elaborate saying that a viral load or viremia is essential for evaluating two factors. The first factor is, as we're discussing now, long-term prognosis can be evaluated based on the viral load. And second thing is, even therapeutic value, that means the effects of your antiviral agents, can also be evaluated based on the viral load. So these are two important factors which can be evaluated based on the viral load. Viral load helps not only in determining the long-term prognosis, but also therapeutic value of various antiviral agents, right? In fact, viral load and CD4 are closely correlated. It means their levels depend on each other. In fact, more viral load, CD4 count also diminishes. So there is quite a relation between the two. However, viral load is the best predictor for long-term prognosis. And along with that, CD4 count is specifically used for evaluating the short-term impact of the infection. So that's been elaborated, or that's been mentioned in internal medicine textbook also, right? So viral load is considered to be more appropriate. And in order to justify what I have been explaining, they even quoted one study saying that those patients, before that, viral load is nothing but viruses present in the body of a HIV patient, in specific, in the blood. It's nothing but viremia as well as HIV RNA virus. So they say the rate, the commonly used term viral load has been coined to include viremia as well as HIV RNA virus levels. And most importantly, those patients with a viral load consistently greater than 10,000 copies per ml have a 10 times higher risk of progressing to AIDS in the coming 5 years compared to those patients who have a viral load of less than 10,000 copies per ml. It means those who are having more amount of viral load in their blood, obviously they are more prone for entering into AIDS in the coming 5 years, right? So this viral load can be used as a parameter to evaluate the long-term prognosis that is justified. And also they say that HIV RNA or viral load is a standard marker of treatment efficacy, with their levels falling in response to introduction of various antiviral medications. So the viral load is also very sensitive to various medications, antiviral medications. So if the levels fall, it means the medication which you are giving is more effective. If the levels continue to raise, it means the medication, antiviral medication, is not that effective. So as we discussed in the beginning, viral load can be used as a long-term prognostic factor evaluator as well as to evaluate treatment efficacy, right? I hope it's clear. So they justify saying that although a correlation exists between viral load and CD4 cell numbers, the viral load appears to be the best indicator of long-term prognosis, very, very important. While the CD4 count will give the warning of risks of immediate or short-term problems, right? So option A is more appropriate. I hope it's clear. Yes, Pragati. Fine. So I hope you got the concept right. Now let's move on to the next question. Fine. And it's streaming. It seems to be streaming fine, Soumya. Okay, now moving on to third question. Very interesting, again, because the question allows you to think and choose a more appropriate answer based on logic. Let's see, gold standard for investigating colorectal cancer is. Gold standard for investigating colorectal cancer. Option A, blood count and routine biochemistry. Option B, colonoscopy. Option C, double contrast barium edema. Option D, CT and PET scan, PET, computerized tomography and positron emission tomography scanning. So I mean the four, which one is a gold standard for investigating colorectal cancer? Blood count and routine biochemistry, colonoscopy, double contrast barium edema, CT and PET scanning. So which one do you think is more appropriate? Kaishwarya Parichay Ganga says colonoscopy. Sanjay. Hi Sanjay. You're having some background music, if you can really hear. Srish says CT and PET scan, because computerized tomography, positron emission tomography help in really evaluating the size, orientation of tumors, isn't it? BA says option C, double contrast barium edema. Unfortunately, this is largely replaced by CT nowadays. Yes, so as we'll go by the majority, obviously, so it is colonoscopy. So they say what you can see is what you can really treat. So colonoscopy is considered to be gold standard for investigating colorectal cancer, right? So make a note of it, very, very important. Also, when you're going through these questions, make sure that you have your printed question so that you can just make a note of them simultaneously. And also, it's better if you can have customized notes, right? So make these arrangements so that will be helpful for you in long run. So colonoscopy is gold standard for investigating and allows biopsies. So obviously we can take biopsy wherever necessary and even perform polypectomies to obtain specimens for histologic examination. So colonoscopy is considered to be gold standard. Blood count and routine biochemistry is not of gold standard. It's done routinely for any other pathology, isn't it? Double contrast barium edema, as one of you said, can visualize large bowel but is now being largely replaced by CT pneumocolon. So we use CT for it. And CT and PET scanning, PET scanning, help to evaluate tumor size, local and secondary spread, and hepatic metastasis. Right? These are other uses of various investigations. In fact, among investigations of colorectal cancer, all of the following can be used, but gold standard is obviously colonoscopy. Right? So option B is more appropriate. Good. Now let's move on to penultimate question. Quite interesting. Let's see. Charcot's joints are painful, not painful, increasingly painful, none of the above. So what is Charcot's joints? So by the way, Charcot is a name of a scientist who describe this condition for the first time. Yes, Ganga. Ganga says not painful. Okay, Aishwarya also the same. Farheen, hi. You say not painful. Okay. There's no option, no idea, Sanjay. So you can choose B, D then. Exactly, Bernice. No sensation. So it's a neuropathic condition, a neurologic situation. It's nothing. Charcot joints are also called as neuropathic joints, where there is trauma to joints because of loss of sensation to pain, which is quite interesting. So Charcot's joints, also called as neuropathic joints, are joints which are damaged by trauma as a result of loss of protective pain sensation. So Charcot's joints are not painful. However, occasionally we can have painful scenarios because of deposition of various crystals as quoted in the literature. So neuropathic joints, Charcot's joints, are joints damaged by trauma as a result of loss of protective pain sensation. And these were first described by Charcot in relation to tapes dorsalis, which we come across in syphilis, if you remember, syphilitic myelopathy. And also Charcot's joints are also seen in syringomyelia, diabetes mellitus, and leprosy. So syringomyelia is nothing but cysts in spinal cord. So we have another important point here. Charcot's joints are not painful. They are also seen in tapes dorsalis, diabetes mellitus, leprosy, as well as syringomyelia. Syringomyelia, right? You can make a note of this list. And as we discussed, the characteristic presentation or finding in Charcot's joint is swollen joint. There is swelling with abnormal movements without any pain. However, there may be painful episodes associated with crystal deposition. Right? So you can just make a note of these additional points. So Charcot's joints are not painful. Option B. Yes, neuropathic myelopathy, where dorsal nerves and all are destroyed. Good. Now let's complete our today's session with our final question. Coarctation of aorta. You might have heard of this term, even in tetralogy of Fallot, where you have four conditions, ventricular subtle effects, overriding of aorta, patent ductus arteriosus, and coarctation of aorta. So what is this coarctation of aorta? So I've asked you the meaning of this. Coarctation of aorta refers to widening of aorta, flexing of aorta, patent iota, none of the above. Yes, Parisha, do find out and let me know which crystals are deposited. I'll be glad if you can find out and let me know. So which one do you think gives the more appropriate answer? Coaptation of iota refers to. Yes, Devuna. Devuna says narrowing. Aishwarya says none of the above. I would never give option D as an answer for any of the MCQs which I create. But I've done it for the first time. Yes, Sanjay Ganga. Good. So coaptation of iota is nothing but narrowing of iota. Narrowing of iota, which can be seen in numerous situations, including tetralogy of Fallot, as we discussed previously, and also in cases Turner syndrome. So make a note of it. Even in Turner syndrome, you have coaptation of iota, and this coaptation of iota is seen usually distal to left subclavian artery, right, or near the opening of patent ductus arteriosus. And what is ductus arteriosus? Can anyone tell me which main vessels does this ductus arteriosus connect? Yes, Pragati. You're right. Good. Yes, it's a congenital condition. Tetralogy of Fallot. And also, patent ductus arteriosus is seen in case of fetus, right? But later it gets closed. And also, as we discussed previously in one of the pharmacology sessions, NSAIDs, aspirin do block this phenomena, thereby leading to persistent patent ductus arteriosus. So what is this patent ductus arteriosus? Or what is ductus arteriosus connect? So that's the question which I have asked. Do you want me to give options? Yes. So there will be a day where if I ask you your name, you might be asking me for options. So that might be a probable and possible scenario in near future. Why options then? Okay, you're right, pulmonary artery and descending aorta. So these are the vessels which are mainly connected by your ductus arteriosus. Septal defect, yeah, ventricular septal defect is again different. Okay, yes, you're right. So it connects pulmonary artery to aorta. And glad that you took some time in order to search in Google. So this coaptation of aorta is seen distal to insertion of ductus arteriosus. So please make a note of these points. Coaptation of aorta is seen, it's narrowing of aorta, which is seen distal to insertion of ductus arteriosus or distal to left subclavian artery. If you remember, from the arch of aorta, you have left subclavian artery and left common carotid artery directly arising from aorta, and on the right side you have brachiocephalic artery, which gives rise to right common carotid and right subclavian artery. We'll discuss all this in detail in anatomy section again. Fine. So left subclavian and left common carotid arise directly from aorta, whereas right subclavian and right common carotid arise from brachiocephalic artery, which in turn arises from aorta. So it will be difficult to imagine, but once you look at the picture, it will be much more clear. And also make a note, patent discoaptation of aorta is associated with Turner syndrome. And severe narrowing of aorta and clinical implications are also very important. Because of this severe narrowing of aorta, there is collateral arterial circulation which involves periscapular and intercostal arteries. Because of this narrowing of aorta, there will be collateral circulation being developed in order to compensate for this narrowing. And also, there will be decreased renal perfusion. Obviously, when the aorta is constricted, the amount of blood going into systemic circulation also decreases, right? So there will be decreased renal perfusion, which can lead to development of systemic hypertension that persists even after surgical correction, right? Do make a note of this point as well. Right? Yes. So this completes our today's discussion. So we'll just have a summary of all that we have discussed so far. So initially we have gone through the onset time in botulism. So go through what is botulism, the organisms responsible for it, what is the time lag for development of initial symptoms, and also what is the onset time, which is the time interval between the first symptom and first spasm. And we have a wide array of clinical manifestations which are really very important, so which are basically dependent on the spasm. So there is, in extreme cases, spasm of various muscles, right, because of neurotoxin which is being elaborated by botulinum, right, so Clostridium botulinum. And also we have gone through the best predictor for long-term prognosis of HIV, which is viral load, which is considered to be more appropriate than the CD4 count, right. And also various investigative methods and gold standard investigation method for colorectal cancer. And also we have gone through Charcot's joints, so why this condition arises and the clinical features and the person who discovered this. And finally, coarctation of aorta, right? So where do you see, in which conditions, and also what would be the possible clinical effects of the coarctation of aorta, right? So option D, by the way, is right answer for the final equation. So I hope it's clear. So this is what I wanted to highlight pertaining to general medicine. So tomorrow we shall have more questions from our cumulative test 1, which includes oral path, oral medicine, dental anatomy, oral histology, as well as I think DOOH. And what else? There is another one subject. Oral path and medicine, yeah, oral radiology, of course. So tomorrow we'll have few more topics from the same, dental anatomy, oral histology, oral radiology, oral medicine and oral path. Okay, so I hope it's clear. If you have any further questions, do let me know. Drop a mail at proudtobedentist@gmail.com. And also Parichay, if you are watching it live now, do find out what the crystals are which are deposited in Charcot's joints and get back to me by mail. We shall have a discussion if necessary. It's for long term. For short term, CD4 count is more appropriate. Fine. And last week we had this fun fest. We'll plan another fun fest soon. I'll let you know the dates. And also, as we have been highlighting repeatedly, there is ample time for you, but make sure that you're utilizing to the maximum level possible. Right. So if you have any challenges you're facing while you're preparing in specific, drop a mail. We'll see what we can do in order to overcome them. Challenges doesn't mean you should stop and worry, but rather it means it's an opportunity for you to identify and move on, isn't it? So no matter what the scenario is, do let us know. And I say it's not really that easy. So having internship, or maybe one, even if you're done with internship, preparing 24/7 is a major challenge. In fact, studies show that it's not that easy to sit and study with focus. To study with focus, you need to utilize a lot of energy, which is really not that easy, provided we have these distractions. So because of a lot many distractions in modern day, we really struggle to focus, right? So it in fact utilizes or uses up most of your willpower. So to restore your willpower, make sure that your glucose levels are normal. You will not feel frustrated. Even if you're feeling low, take a break, have a healthy snack, and then get back again, right? So we have numerous tips which you can follow. And if in case you are facing any major challenge in trying to master a specific topic. Use Feynman's technique, which we discussed in detail previously, right? So all that we need is the effort which you are putting in. So that's more important than anything else now. No matter how many videos you're watching, no matter how many tests you're giving, it doesn't matter as long as you don't put the required effort which is needed. So question yourself how many hours you are allotting every day. And the best answer to how many hours one should allot every day is the maximum time which you can. So the maximum amount of time which you can allot on a particular day for prep should be customized and don't go by the fancy numbers. And to keep a tab on your preparation, take it very seriously. Take printouts of daily schedules or weekly schedules. If you think you need any changes, customize them, take a printouts, get the spiral binding done, fill them up, watch them, just keep a tab on how your preparation is going on day-to-day basis, weekly basis. You need any assistance, always drop a mail, right? So consistency is what is required. Often we see most of you working extremely hard, but inconsistently, which would obviously dilute your entire preparation, isn't it? So hard work is of course needed. At the same time, you should have that consistent effort which you should put in right from day one. And it's not just one day game or T20, you should have this continuous consistent effort, and then it's obviously going to be beautiful, isn't it? You're all doing this for sake of cracking entrance, and consider this as a minor challenge. Maybe you feel like it's a major hurdle now, but believe me, it's only one of the minor challenges which you're facing now. In life, obviously, we have several challenges. So this, it's like a warm-up for you. So this is only a minor challenge which you can easily overcome by sticking on to few basics, right? Since we have done it previously, based on experience and based on our observation, we're giving you many inputs, but doesn't mean that it works for you. It has to be customized. So observe how your prep is going on, see how you're spending your time, and customize your preparation accordingly, right? So don't go blindly based on what others say. Customize it and then give your best. And obviously the best comes to you, as I keep on saying, right? So believe in yourself. And I highlight these three factors always. It's not just hard work and consistency, of course self-belief. Because I've seen many of them failing, not because of they lack in hard work or consistency, but because they lack in self-belief. So if you believe in yourself, it's not a miracle. If one can achieve it, anyone can achieve it, right? Entrance or whatever it is, right? No matter what task you're taking up. So believe in yourself and give your best. Obviously the best comes to you. Right, so we'll have a tomorrow session as usual by 8 p.m. And if you have any further questions, always drop a mail at proudtobeintrested@gmail.com. So it's been a pleasure interacting with you all live, and see you again tomorrow at 8 p.m. Love you all. Take care. Yes, Parichay. Yes, Sri Shaishwaryam. Yes, Radu. Devna, Sanjay, hi Freedom Fighter, Ganga, you're most welcome. Fine? Yeah, see you tomorrow again. Bye. And I hope you liked our new setting also. And if in case there is any explanation needed, we'll shift towards the board, right? Yeah. Bye.